Yo, what's up guys, Atlas here with
Phoenix Eye.
So today we're going to talk about the top 5 favorite cards.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, the ones, cards we just like, they don't have to be good or anything, just cards we really like. So my number 5 is Magician's Souls. Now everything about this card is perfect besides its price tag, it's a bit an expensive side.
Yeah.
But it's a really, really solid card. So in order to summon it, you need to send, well, there's also some Dark Magician effects, but who plays Dark Magicians? So you send a level 6 or higher spellcaster from your deck to the grave. And if you do, you can special summon it. They have a free level 1 summon, which is already very great in certain strategies. And at that point, you can send spell traps from your hand or from your field to the grave to draw cards equal to the amount of spell traps you send. This is a really great card in a lot of combo strategies, and that's why I like it. It's very useful. It has its uses in a lot of decks.
It just seems like a very good generic spellcast support card.
Yeah. For example, Fortune Ladies, they have a search spell that doesn't really do much. It's a continuous spell.
Yeah.
The other effects don't really do much. You can search, then send it away for the free draw.
Fair enough, yeah.
It just has a lot of synergy, and it's one of my favorite monsters. It's strong, but not necessarily overpowered.
That's always a good balance. Yeah.
And it looks cool.
Mm-hmm.
I guess that's the thing.
Yeah, fair
What's
enough.
Your number 5?
Well, mine is going to be a bit more thematic, not really focused on the effect, but Skull Servant. It's going to sound really stupid, but I just like the idea that there's like this one card that's just completely irrelevant in all forms. Just like from the first set of Yu-Gi-Oh! There's just this one random normal monster that wasn't even like any high rarity, wasn't it just like a random common.
Common, I think.
And they decided to build an entire archetype around it for some fucking reason.
Yeah.
I think it's like a very, very funny story behind the card, essentially.
I mean, I get where you're coming from, fair enough. I mean, yeah, it's funny indeed. I miss playing Skull Servants with that Grasslook Screener. You know that card?
Yeah, I know what it does. It just kind of can mill a good part of your deck.
Just mill 20 cards in Skull Servant deck. That's pretty good.
Yeah, exactly.
So, my number 4 is Caius the Shadow Monarch. Now, the classic Monarchs are something I really, really liked. When I picked up the Monarch Structure deck a few years ago, I hoped to get a similar experience, but it was just a boring breakfast. But Caius the Shadow Monarch, I just think the artwork is cool and the effect is simple yet cool. You basically banish a card. If it's a dark monster, your opponent takes 1,000 damage. I don't know, it's just iconic and cool, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, Monarchs in general are like cool bombastic cards, usually.
And in 5D's era, like quick draw Doppelwire and stuff, that time, you know, peak 5D's era before Inferity ruined the game. Caius was also a staple.
Fair enough, yeah.
So it saw a lot of play. So that's my number 4.
Fair enough.
Number 4 is...
It's Exodia, the forbidden one. That one that is... its name should imply that it's banned, but apparently it's not.
Yeah.
No, it's like... Just like the idea of...
Just imagine an Iwata, the weaker version, called Exodia Limited one.
Oh, that would be hilarious. Just like, if you collect all 3 P's, you get a decent beat stick. No, just like the idea of like one card that is, thematically it's like, it is just a monster that is so strong that your opponent doesn't even have to attempt to do anything against it, you just win, they just lose.
Yeah.
It's just a good meme card, and I think it isn't very often that you see someone lose to an Exodia deck and actually be angry. It's like, usually when someone pulls off Exodia, you're like impressed, like...
Except there's one clip from that guy Legs you have to do. Well, of Queens, Graceful Charity. Exodia. The shit post. But yeah, Exodia is very iconic as well.
Yeah, exactly.
You don't hate losing against it. Well, maybe in a competitive setting. But yeah. My number 3 is Overdrive Teleporter. It's a level 6 psychic light monster. Only light monster on this list, by the way. Oops. It cannot be special summoned. So it has to be normal summoned. Once, if this card's on the field, you can pay 2,000 life points. Special summon 2 level 3 monsters from your deck. Level 3 psychics.
Yeah, that definitely sounds very powerful.
Yeah, it's a very powerful card. This card alone, a while back, before a lot of banlist changes happened, was like 6 negates. Summoning it.
It's pretty disgusting.
Because it's a level 6, it summons a tuner. Yeah, you can imagine shedding it. But this thing, the art is very cool as well. Something about the art is like divine, like for Sayer from 5D just posing. Then it just looks nice. It just looks really nice. The effect is really cool, and yeah, I just really like the card.
Fair enough.
So, what's your number 2?
I'm going to pull up with an obscure one, Spirit of Flames. I looked it up. This is the fire monster all the way back from GX era that can summon itself for free if you banish a monster from the fire monster from your graveyard. Just like besides, it's also a 2K beach stick, just for like the games that happen in that era. It's a fun card to use because it just, especially if you have a very fire-centered strategy, it's just a very easy summon and allows you to do just consistent tribute summons as well, and it just makes for a good combat card.
Yeah,
because it's just a heartbeat stick as well.
Yeah, fair enough. It's a cool card.
And I also like the art.
Also, random fun fact about Overdrive Teleporter.
Mm-hmm.
It got a printing as a secret
in
a 5D set, and that's the only printing.
Oh yeah, that's kind of sad.
If it ever becomes a good card,
it will be expensive as fuck.
I'm already glad I have one copy. That card just like, not affordable.
Yeah, if they're ever going to give good psychic support, it's just going to jump up in price.
So, anyways, my number two is a mouthful.
Mm-hmm.
Cherubini, Eben Angel of the Burning Abyss. it's the frontman of the 3-axis strategy.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, it says it's a link. It requires two level 3 monsters, so basically it's an Xyz.
Fair enough.
As a cost, you can send a level 3 monster from the deck to the graveyard.
Mm-hmm.
And if you do, increase its attack by the same amount of attack.
Oh yeah, so it's just milling.
So my favorite part is people throwing effect fighter at it.
Oh, I don't get my attacking game. Don't get my attack game. Okay.
It's like Dante also mills for cost. A lot of people forget that as well.
Yeah.
And then it just, I like Ash. Okay, you can't Ash, you take it back, but you now know he has Ash.
Fair enough, yeah, true.
But yeah, the thing with Cherubini is just it enables a lot of strategies.
Mm-hmm.
Infinities, in the current state, without Cherubini, nope.
Fair enough. It sounds like a very easy way to mill cards.
Yeah, it's also a big combo piece, a lot of strategies, and it just makes a lot of strategies possible.
Mm-hmm.
And the last sanctioned big YCS, YCS Utrecht, some Mad Lads actually got like second place with 3-axis. Something which was just 60 cards stacked on top of each other that somehow worked.
That sounds pretty
like, literally,
pretty cool,
you had a pretty solved meta. Everyone knew which decks were going to win. And this guy comes in, sadly got second place, but people won't forget him. That was amazing.
Sounds cool, yeah.
And just, it's a very cool card.
Mm-hmm.
What's your number two?
Pajama King, because I like pajamas. And it...
Fair.
And, I mean, just the idea, like, you the lock of three monster zones, I think there's honestly a lot of decks that will be really damaged by the fact that they cannot put more than three monsters on the field initially.
Yeah. They have to extra monster zone, which kind
of... Yeah, exactly, but if you cannot do link summons because you don't have any link twos, then you can also just not do anything from there.
And not forget the new Ojama card.
Yeah, exactly, Ojama Pink is there.
Locks another monster zone.
Mm-hmm.
Well, if you just make King and use Pink's effect, you only have one monster zone.
Yep, and then it's... Like, unless your opponent has a specific strategy that counters it or has like any sort of easy destruction card, then the whole festivity is going to end, especially for such an old card that's just, it still has a pretty strong effect.
Oh yeah, definitely. Anyways, my number one, Destiny Hero Diamond Dude.
Fair enough.
The card's very gimmicky in a fun way.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, you activate the top card of your deck, and if it's a spell, you can use it the next turn from your graveyard for free, ignoring any costs. For example, you have Beginning of the End, which says you need to have like 8 Darks to your grave activated, or like 5, I'm not sure.
Mm-hmm.
But you need a lot of Darks to your grave, banish a lot of them, then draw 3 cards.
Yeah.
And the Diamond Duty just becomes draw 3 cards.
Yeah.
Like, it's so ridiculous.
It definitely feels like if you build a strategy around with just a lot of stupid expensive spell cards in Diamond Duty, it definitely feels like a fun way of gambling.
I've done it before.
Mm-hmm.
There was a spell card called Silver Charity. Draw 2 cards or 3 cards, reveal Sylvans if you don't have any Sylvans, and stack your entire deck hand on top of your deck.
Mm-hmm.
And then you can just cheese out cards like Rank of Magic 7th one and just use them without cost.
Fair enough. That's pretty fucking funny.
Yeah, it is. It's one of my favorite cards. It's just, it enables an entire playstyle on its own.
Yeah.
It's a shame Diamond, I mean Destiny Heroes in general just aren't that great.
Yeah.
Otherwise it would be a great
Diamond card. Is definitely fun.
Yeah, one of my favorite cards of all time.
Fair enough.
What's your number one?
Legendary Six Samurai Shien.
Oh, not Gateway?
No, not Gateway. I mean, I could have put Gateway there as well. It's just, I feel like Shien is like the perfect like poster boy of Six Samurai in a way. It's like the card that people think of when they think of the archetype. It's still, a spell negate is still pretty good to this day. And it's just, it's a very iconic card. And I think just he looks cool and he feels cool and just feels nice to use.
Fun fact, I used to really, really hate that card.
Yeah, because...
I played a lot against a friend of mine.
Mm-hmm.
I played Stahlburn.
Ah, fair.
He played Six Samurai.
Yeah, especially all the formats, just once per turn spell negation can be very fatal for spell heavy deck.
Oh yes, definitely, definitely.
Mm-hmm.
But that were our favorite cards.
Yeah, that rounds off.
What's your favorite card? Tell us in the comments. See you guys next time. Atlas signing out.
You.
Peace.